हेलो एवरीवन, कैन यू हियर मी? हाँ
यस सर। सर आई थिंक आई हैव बीन लेफ्ट आउट फ्रॉम योर गूगल ग्रुप बिकॉज टुडे एंड द डे बिफोर येस्टरडे आई डिड नॉट रिसीव एनी लिंक। सो कैन यू जस्ट लुक इन टू दिस
नॉट
मैटर?
या आई डिड नॉट सेंड एनी लिंक बिकॉज आई अज्यूम दैट आई मीन बिकॉज आई एम चेंजिंग एग्जैक्टली द सेम मीटिंग अगेन एंड अगेन, सो आई हैव नॉट सेंड एनी ईमेल.
ओके सेम लिंक।
यस. So
ओके
I'm
सर।
exactly the same meeting. I'm just going on changing the time because every time you have to set up a meeting, what happens is you have to change the meeting options, you have to invite people and so on. So, but it's much easier if we can maintain exactly the same meeting because all the lecture notes are also available in the same chat box and
Okay,
you know all the
sir.
meeting options are saved. So
So I can just log into this
yes,
using the yesterday's
exactly,
link. Okay, sir.
exactly. Okay.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir.
Okay, there was another meeting going on, so I thought while that is going on, I can also show you certain things. So that is what I was looking at. Right. Okay. So we were discussing band structure and using the tight binding method. And basically, what I said was that if you had a 1D monoatomic lattice with one non-degenerate orbital, then what one can show is that EK is basically minus 2T cos KA. Okay. And if you had similarly a 2D version of the same thing, then you can show that it is going to be minus 2t cos kxa plus cos kya. All right. So now what one can see from here is that if I take, let's say, this ek or any one of this, so let's say I take this ek and then expand it. So do a Taylor's expansion about k equal to 0. Okay. Then what one can see is that this will give us minus 2t into 1 minus k squared a squared by 2. Okay. And then of course there are other terms like this. So this I can write as minus 2t plus t times a squared times k squared. Okay, so given this kind of relation, right, and then there are other terms, one can see that there is a k squared term that is arising. Okay, and if you remember the free electron dispersion is basically ek is minus h cross squared k squared by 2m. Sorry, this is plus. So if I take this free electron dispersion and then find the double derivative of this, so let's say I do this, then what do I get? I get h cross squared by m, right? So using this relation, what we can do is we can actually define the effective mass of the system because this tells us that M inverse is basically 1 over h cross squared times d2 ek by dk squared. Okay. So if I now take this relation, which is a Taylor's expansion around the gamma point, which is k equal to 0, the center of the Brillouin zone. So this is also called the gamma point. So if I do this and then again apply exactly the same relation, okay, that is, I take the double derivative, then what do I get? I get 1 by h cross squared d2 ek by dk squared. I'll get from here, I'll get 2 t a squared by h cross squared. Okay, so this implies the effective mass at the gamma point is given by h cross squared by 2t a squared. So this is one thing, and then the other thing that comes out from here is that the band is parabolic at k equal to 0. Okay, so it looks like the usual non-interacting conduction band that we draw near the k equal to 0. So this is k, and the curvature of this, right, the curvature of this is actually determined by the ta squared, where if you remember, t is actually the overlap element, the transition, the matrix element of the delta u operator between the nearest neighbor vanier atomic orbitals. So that is what determines the curvature of this conduction band, whereas for free electrons it's just h cross squared by 2m. It's just the bare mass 1 over m that determines the curvature. Yes. Yes, Shovik. I'm not able to hear you.
Sir, what did you just say? Can you just repeat?
Yeah, I was saying that if you see the free electron dispersion, then the h cross squared by 2m determines the curvature of the free electron band near k equal to 0. Whereas in the tight binding case, so remember, in the free electron dispersion, there was no periodic potential. But when we bring back the periodic potential, what I'm trying to show you is that near k equal to 0, you again get a free electron picture. Okay, so how do we see that? By doing a Taylor's expansion around k equal to 0, and then seeing that the Ek is basically some reference energy, which is minus 2t, and then plus a term which is quadratic in k, that is k squared. And the curvature here is not determined, or the curvature here can be represented as a kind of an effective mass. Okay, and that effective mass can be found out by using the second derivative of the Ek with respect to k. And what that gives us is that the M effective at the gamma point is h cross squared by 2t a squared. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so what this is telling us is that if the T is large, then the effective mass is small. But if the T is small, then the effective mass would be large. Okay. Now, what does T determine? Okay. So T, first of all, let us try to remember what was T. Okay. So T, if you remember, was basically this chi n plus 1. Okay. So this is the matrix element of the interatomic potential. Okay. And it's a matrix element with respect to the nearest neighbor atomic orbitals. And what we are saying here is that if the T is small, then this band is going to be highly curved. Okay, the curvature is going to be extremely large. Right. So that's what this is saying. And the other thing is, you can see from here that if the T is extremely small, this is going to be flatter and flatter. Okay, and in the limit that T tends to zero, you'll basically get a flat band, right? What that is telling you is that in the limit T tends to zero, the overlap or the matrix element is vanishing, and hence you are seeing almost a flat band, which means there is no dispersion. There is no continuum of energies. You are basically maintaining the same atomic energy as in the case of an isolated atom. Okay, but when the T is large, then you have a strong curvature. Okay, and that's when you are able to describe it as a normal conduction band. Okay, so this band formation in this system is determined completely by this Hopping integrals. And the other thing is that if you remember, minus 2t cos ka implies that we have a certain bandwidth. Okay, and the bandwidth of this system was given by 4 times t. Okay, so if the bandwidth is large, and that has to come from the Hopping integral being large. Okay, so what this is telling you is that the effective mass is inversely proportional to the bandwidth. This is a very important conclusion that you must remember, that if you have a narrow band, then the effective mass is going to be large. if you have a wide band, the effective mass is going to be small. Okay, so this is also useful in many different cases. It turns out that there are semiconductors where the effective masses could be large, or they could even be smaller than the bare effective mass. So the bare electron mass. The bare electron mass is just 9.1 and 10 to the power minus 31 kgs. But in certain systems, because of this periodic potential, you can find that the effective mass, or the mass with which these electrons move around in semiconductors, is not the same as the normal electron mass. Okay, it can get renormalized, and that renormalization happens because of the periodic potential. Okay, so any questions so far? Good. So if you now look at the 2D case also, exactly the same thing can be done. If I expand this the EK around KX equal to 0, KY equal to 0, then I would again get a term which is very similar to this. But in that case, you can see that you will have an effective mass which could be different in principle along different directions. Okay, so let me show you that. So in the 2D case, EK was minus 2T cos KXA plus cos KYA. Okay. Now, we got this by assuming something which is completely isotropic. That is, the T does not depend on which direction you're taking the overlap. But imagine that you had some kind of a directionality in your system. Let's say you had px orbitals, or dxy, dxz, and so on. So there is a directionality in the orbitals. And if that is the case, then the overlap of these orbitals along certain directions will be different from the overlap in the different directions. Okay. So in which case you could get, okay, in principle, something like this, minus 2t1 cos kxa minus 2t2 cos kya, or we can probably write this as tx and ty. You could have, for example, different overlaps. Okay, so in an anisotropic system. And if that happens, then you can see that if I now expand this around the gamma point, then what I would get is so minus 2t plus 2tx kx squared a squared by 2 and plus 2ty ky squared a squared by 2. Okay, so this can be now written as some reference energy, and then a term which is tx a squared kx squared plus ty ky squared a squared. Okay, so now you can see that the effective mass is not the same in the x direction and the y direction, in different directions. And that can be simply understood by taking this and then trying to visualize this in k space. Okay, so what would this look like in k space? And you can see that near the k equal to 0 point, near the gamma point, this is going to be a paraboloid. So in 1D case, we just found a parabola. And in the 2D case, you can just take this parabola and then rotate it about the Z axis, right? So that is what is called a paraboloid. But then this paraboloid is different because you have different curvatures in different directions. Okay, so that is the reason why you can get effective mass which is different in different directions. And you can see how complicated it can be in three dimensions when at each point in the Brillouin zone, you could have a different effective mass. But not only a different effective mass, you could also have different directions. Okay, or the effective mass is actually a full tensor, right? So what one does is that one can define in general a term like this. Okay, and that would be now the effective mass. Right, but then this is the effective mass tensor. So you can define a full effective mass tensor in this way, which is not defined only along the principal axis, but you can have it in general along all the different directions. Okay, so this is only in the kx, ky. You could in general have a ki, kj. right? So this is inverse, sorry. All right, so the concept of effective mass is only useful if you can do a Taylor's expansion and you get a quadratic dispersion, okay? So the question then is, can somebody tell me why would or in which system could this be a useful concept? So to give you some examples, you can consider metals, for example, semiconductors, superconductors, insulators, magnets. So in which system would this effective mass concept be the most useful? You can do it by elimination, for example. Would it be useful in metals, for example? Any idea? Ashish?
In case of metals, will the T be large?
So Shomita, is this Shomita?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So in the case of metals, T is usually quite large. Yes. So the point that I'm trying to ask you is this Taylor's expansion? See, the effective mass concept is crucially dependent on the Taylor's expansion around the gamma point. Okay. Yeah. Now, in a metal, all the dynamics happens around the Fermi level. Okay. And because the density of electrons is quite high in a metal, the Fermi level is usually very far from the gamma point. Okay, so a Taylor's expansion would not really be valid, and I'll show you certain band structures in which you can see that the quadratic band that I have drawn here is not actually valid in real metals. Okay, so a quadratic expansion or an expansion to just quadratic order is not really good for metals. You have to go far beyond that, or you have to consider the full band structure. So essentially what I'm trying to say is that the density of electrons has to be sufficiently low, okay, in such a way that you could consider levels which are very close to the gamma point, so that only a few of these levels are filled up and rest of them are empty. Now that happens in which system?
Semiconductors,
exactly. So in semiconductors, you have levels which are very close to the conduction band minimum that are filled up, right? At 0 Kelvin, of course, only the valence band is completely filled and the conduction band is completely empty. But at any finite temperature, you will find that a small number of electrons have transitioned into the conduction band. I'm talking about intrinsic semiconductors with no disorder, no impurities, etc. And for those systems, you can now think of the conduction band minimum or the levels near the conduction band minimum being populated. And for those levels, you could define a kind of an effective mass tensor. Okay. And it turns out that it is actually a very useful concept, because once you use this effective mass concept, you can take the dispersion to be just purely quadratic. Okay. So normally the dispersion, I will show you certain band structures now, and you will see that the dispersion is very unlike that of free electrons, especially as you go farther away from the minima or the maxima. Okay. Near minima or maxima, you could do a Taylor's expansion, but as soon as you go far from them, it's nothing like that. It could even be linear, it could be cubic, it could be all kinds of structures up there, right? So in many calculations, so when I say calculations, what I mean is, let's say you want to model a certain transistor, okay, and it's a silicon MOSFET, for example, and you want to do a model calculation of that. Then you would try to implement the drift diffusion equations, but in implementing the drift diffusion equations, one has to incorporate the band structure, okay, because if you don't incorporate the band structure, it's as if you are doing a very generic system. And instead of silicon, you could in fact be doing iron, or you could be doing copper, for example. So it doesn't really matter. So unless you incorporate the band structure, the material specificity does not come into play. Okay, so the silicon band structure tells you that the conduction band and there is a certain valence band and there's a conduction band, and very few electrons would have transitioned into the conduction band. And these drift diffusion equations would become extremely complicated if you incorporate the realistic band structure of the system. Okay, so it's a very big simplification if you can use the effective mass picture and use a quadratic dispersion wherever possible in the drift diffusion equations. The solution becomes far, far simpler. Okay, so and this is actually what I'm trying to tell you is not a small thing, because if you think about the chip makers, the Intel, IBM, and many other, you know, Apple, for example, now that's they're doing. So all of these companies, they have invested, hundreds of millions of dollars in these kind of modeling techniques. Because when you want to fabricate something, it's very, very costly. So if you have a certain calculation which is predicting that, okay, with this kind of a configuration or with this kind of a geometry or with this kind of a doping profile, you can get a very efficient transistor, then they can go ahead and fabricate that. So the theory team in these companies, for example, they have worked a lot and implemented these kind of formalisms, the effective mass formalism, the drift diffusion formalism, Boltzmann transport equation formalism, which we are going to do next, in order to model transistors or any other electronic components. Okay, starting from taking input from the first principles. So these things are not just academic concepts, they are extremely, extremely useful concepts. Okay, and these days, density functional theory plays a very, very important role in the technology industry. So I hope the concept of the effective mass is clear. If there are any doubts, just let me know now. Okay. All right. So so there is a certain concept that I wanted to bring in, and this is something that most of us take it as given. Which is electrons in a completely filled band cannot carry current. Okay, so yeah, Ashish, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So Ashish, you know, we talk about these insulators and we say that there are these two bands and there is a huge band gap. And because the lower band is completely full and the upper band is completely empty, it's an insulator, correct?
Yes.
Now, see, there are two different spaces that we are connecting here, because when we talk about the band structure, it's actually a K-space concept, correct? It's actually EK versus K that we are talking about. And we say that in the EK versus K space, there is a gap between the two bands. And at normal temperatures like 300 Kelvin, the electrons will not be able to cross that band gap. And hence, you will not get any current. Okay?
Yes, sir.
But transport is a real space concept, which is that if you apply an electric field, then electrons will not be able to propagate from one end of the system to the other end of the system. Correct?
Right.
So how do you connect these two spaces? And where does this intuition come from, that if the electrons belong to, or if a certain band is completely filled, why can it not carry any current? If it is completely empty, that is very, you know, that is very obvious, because there are just no electrons in that, so it cannot carry current. But if there is a completely filled band, why can it not carry current?
Because sir, current, if we say material is conductive, then it will allow charge to move.
Sorry.
Inside. If we say current, if we have current, then we can say this can be conductive also, because the charge can move.
Correct. So what we are saying is, suppose I give you a completely filled band, okay, and you tell me that if there is a completely filled band and the band above this is completely empty, this system cannot carry any current, it's an insulator. Okay. Yes, I am asking you for the logic underlying that statement. It's a k-space picture, right? That we are trying to connect to real space.
Yeah, yes, sir.
Hmm. So how does that happen? Any idea? Anyone? Is the periodicity of the system of the potential important at all in this case? It turns out that this is crucially dependent on the periodicity of the system. Okay. And first of all, we get band structure only because there is a periodic potential. If there was no periodic potential and the electrons are moving about in vacuum, we would not get bands, right? That's the first thing. Second thing is that I'm going to show you the proof of this, and you will see how these two pictures are connected. Okay. So, okay, just before that, let me show you what these band structures actually look like. So here I have shown, or here it's shown, this is a certain paper. So can you all see this?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So this is actually in K space. So you see this Z, X, and Y. You see these three axes. This is actually KX, KY, KZ. Okay. And in this space, you see the center is called gamma. That's a gamma point. And then there is an X point here on this square surface. Okay. Now, what is this surface showing, right? This surface is actually showing the Brillouin zone, okay, of this system of silicon. This is actually silicon. And the same thing is now shown here. Remember, silicon, if you take bulk silicon, it's a three-dimensional system. So you would have band structure in three different directions, Kx, Ky, Kz. Okay. So the Ek will be a function of Kx, Ky, and Kz, right? So how does one show the band structure? Right. So we will see that in the next slide. But before that, I want to show you something here, which is if I take a particular direction, let's say gamma point to X point. Okay. So that is how actually band structure is shown. You take a certain direction in K space. So you can take, for example, gamma to X, or you could take gamma to L to U to X. Okay. So U is actually the center of this edge in the first Brillouin zone, and L is the center of the hexagon. Okay. Then you could take, for example, gamma point to K to W to X. So you take these high symmetry points in the Brillouin zone, and then you show the Ek versus K along that direction. Okay. So you consider every point here on this gamma to K line. So there would be a certain K value for each of these points. And then you plot that the Ek versus the K points on a certain 1D axis. Okay. So because we are used to looking at projections, okay, on a 2D plane, right? So, but how to show this kind of a 3D band structure on a 2D plane? So what one does is one takes certain high symmetry directions in K space, and along those directions, for each K point, you draw the Ek on the Y axis. Okay, so that's the idea. And what is being shown here is that there are two bands which are which have their maximum at the gamma point. This is K equal to zero. And at the X point, you will see that in the next slide, you will see that at the X point, there is actually a minimum. So this is not visible at all. If you look at the Brillouin zone, it's a three-dimensional Brillouin zone already, right? So you can only show, for example, the contours of the Ek versus K in 3D space. Otherwise, if you have to actually show Ek versus Kx, Ky, Kz, you have to go into four-dimensional space, which is just not possible, right? So this is why this kind of simplified band structures are drawn. And at the X point, you will see that the band gap is roughly 1.12 electron volt. But at the X point, if you look at the valence band, which is here, then there are no states, right? At this point, there are no states. So this the band gap in silicon is actually an indirect band gap, because the band gap is calculated between the gamma point and the X point. Okay, so the gamma point has the valence band maximum and the X point has the conduction band minimum, right? So you calculate that gap between these two and that comes out to be roughly 1.1 electron volts. And if you look at the direct band gap, then that happens to be 3.4 electron volts at the gamma point, right? And if you look at other points, the gap becomes even higher, right? So roughly you can see that at the X point, the direct band gap could be roughly the same, 3.4 electron volts. But at most other points, the band gap is much larger, the direct band gap, okay? So now let me show you the calculated one. So this is, for example, the calculated band structure, okay? Of course, band structure is calculated. If you want to do ARPS, then you can get band structure, but then there are certain interpretations involved, okay? So these are all calculated band structures. Let me show you one second. Yeah, I think this is, yeah, this is, this you can see here. So there is gamma here, there is X, there is K, and then again gamma, right? So you are going from the gamma point to the X point, then from X to K, then K to gamma, okay? And what is drawn here is the EK versus the K. So EK is shown in electron volts, right? You can see this is electron volts. And the gamma point has these two.
Sir, what are X and K points?
Yeah, so let me show you that. Let me go back. So you see here, this X point is actually the center of this square. So this is the Brillouin zone. Okay, this is the Brillouin zone of silicon, first Brillouin zone. And the X point, K point, W point, U, L, and gamma, these are all high symmetry points. Okay. Yes.
I mean, so is it a general notation, like applicable for all kinds of systems?
Yeah. These are, see, usually what happens is that there in a certain community, certain language develops. Okay, so in this solid state community, this is quite well accepted. The gamma point is the center of the first Brillouin zone. And you can name these high symmetry points of different systems by using these kind of letters. Okay, so if you ask any band structure person, then they would tell you precisely how do you define these high symmetry directions and so on. But you can already see that the L point is, for example, the center of this hexagon. Right. If you have taken any generic point, then it would not be a high symmetry point. Okay. So in the sense that this L point occurs exactly, for example, in the other hexagon, in this hexagon, in this hexagon, and so on. So if I calculate the band structure around the L point, then I know the band structure around these other points also. Okay. So they're all related by symmetry. Similarly, the K point is the center of this edge. The X point is the center of this square here. Right. So in this band structure, what one is doing is that one is going from the gamma point to the X point and plotting the EK versus K. Okay. And you can see there are so many different bands that appear, right? So for example, you could take this particular band, and this band you can see is quadratic only near the gamma point. And not only that, if you look at the other band, right, then that has a different curvature than this. Okay, so this actually brings up the concept of heavy holes and light holes. Because remember, in silicon, if some of these electrons make a transition to the conduction band, then what would happen is that there would be holes here. Okay, and these holes would have different effective masses depending on whether they belong to this band or to this band. Right, so let me ask. So Anustup, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So Anustup, you can see that there are these two bands here. One is at the top and one is at the bottom here, right? Which is looking sort of a V shape. Huh? There is one which is looking like an inverted U, and there is another one which is looking like an inverted V, right?
Yes.
So
sir.
Can you tell me which one would have a heavy hole and which one would have a lighter hole?
So the one with the lower curvature.
So which one is that?
The upper one.
So the one with the lower curvature will have heavy holes or lighter holes?
Yes. Heavy holes.
How do you say that?
So M is inversely proportional to the curvature.
Correct. So the curvature is large or small for that?
Oh, yeah.
It's small.
Yes, sir.
Right. So for that, it's quite flat, right? And because
yes,
it's quite flat, it means that the coefficient of the k squared has to be small, which means that the effective mass has to be large. Correct?
Yes, sir.
That's your logic. So this is what is written here. So if we see this, there are two bands that are schematically drawn here, and this is the heavy holes band and this is the light holes band. Okay. So when you consider transport, for example, in silicon system, then you would have to consider different effective masses of coming from these two different bands. Okay. Yeah. Thanks, Anastup. You can mute yourself. So yes. If we go back to this, now you can see that there are several bands here. Okay. And in fact, at the gamma point, you see these electrons which have a negative curvature. Okay. It has a different curvature here. And there are two bands which are almost touching, right? And the band structure can actually be very, very complicated, and there can be multiple different bands. Okay. So, let me show you this. So usually, you know, when you look at talks in the theoretical sciences unit, you will see these kind of spaghetti structure of bands. Okay. And this is actually one of the goals of modern solid state physics, to get the band structure of systems. And very, the technologically important materials, if you can figure out the band structure, including, for example, disorder effects, or including, for example, surface effects, including spin orbit effects and so on, it can be an extremely useful quantity. Okay, because a lot of things like transport, magnetism, and the response of the system and so on, thermodynamic response, as well as the charged response, spin response and so on, depends on what is the band structure of the system. Okay, so now not only that, it also turns out that this band structure has can have topological character. Okay, so I don't think we will have time to go into topological physics in this course, because we have to cover quite a few things, but in case at some point of time we meet, I can tell you how the band structure actually determines topological physics. Okay, especially in only in multiband systems that can happen. So this is how real band structure looks like. And what we are going to do now is that suppose you take T equal to zero, and at zero temperature, all the bands below the Fermi level are completely occupied. So the zero here is the Fermi level, okay? And above the Fermi level, all the bands which are shown in red are unoccupied. So how do we say that this k-space picture translates into a real space statement that the charges which belong to the completely filled band do not carry any current, okay? So let's see how that argument goes. So the total current density would be given by this. J is minus E times integral dk by 4 pi cube 1 by h cross gradient of k of ek. Oh, and one more thing, by the way. So the density functional theory community is a very strong community in JNC. And worldwide, what has happened is that the formalism of density functional theory is now almost 3 to 4 decades old. Okay. So there are very, very sophisticated packages which are available to calculate these band structures. They are highly optimized. And not only that, you have very powerful visualization tools. Okay. So, and in fact, in the computational material science course, you might be looking at using some of these packages to figure out the band structure that I just showed you, let's say of silicon or copper or gold and so on. Okay, so and in fact, you don't even need to do heavy formalism for learning those packages. There are very, very well written tutorials that you can just read through and find out how to construct an input file, how to get the output file, and how to visualize them. You just have to know the meaning of the concepts. Okay. When you get something out, you have to understand, you have to know what is it that you're getting. If you know that, then there are very nice tutorials which explain how to get these properties out. Okay. So I would encourage some of you who are theoretically inclined to just download packages like Quantum Espresso or Abinet. And these packages are all free. right? So, and also there is a lot of documentation that is available, okay? All right, so the total current density of any system of any particular band would be given by the, this is Vk, right? So what we are doing is we are taking NeV, right? So for doing NeV, remember N cannot be all the electrons, okay? Or N has to be dependent on which band you are considering, right? So N and V both are incorporated into this kind of a first gluon zone integral, where we have taken the Vk for each electron. This is 1 by h cross del k, Ek is basically the Vk. So this is Vk. And this is telling us how many states are there, right? So dk by 4 pi cube is the volume space element in k space. So this is going to give us a total current density. And if we look at the energy density, okay, or energy current density, energy density actually, so then the Je is given by integral dk by 4 pi cube. And there is a 4 pi cube and not 8 pi cube because we have considered the spin also. Okay? So that's why the 8 pi cube has become 4 pi cube. And then 1 by h cross del E by del k. Or this is basically grad k of Ek. So what is happening here is that you can see the difference between these two. The minus E is the charge. Okay, so this is actually energy current density, energy current. So this is charge current density and this is energy current density, right? So energy current density, you can replace the charge minus E by the Ek, okay? So energy current density, for example, is important when you are considering thermoelectric applications, okay? And charge current density, of course, is important when you're considering electrical transport. So if you're considering thermal transport and things like that, then this energy current density becomes extremely important. Okay, so given this, what we are going to show is that in a filled band, these integrals, okay, should vanish. That is the essence of the proof. That if you have a completely filled band, so remember this Ek corresponds to specific bands. If you take one band, then the Ek would be different from the band from the Ek of the other bands, right? So dispersion depends on the band structure. And the J, I could write, for example, here an N and N here, right? Which will determine the band index. And what we are saying is that suppose one of the bands is completely full, right? Then you would have to integrate this over the entire Brillouin zone because all the K points in the first Brillouin zone have occupancy one, okay? In other words, what we are saying is, let me go back to that band structure. So let's say I consider this band structure, okay? And I consider the bands in this kind of a valence band, which is closest to the Fermi level. And here I say that all these single particle levels in this band are occupied, okay? Then you can see that in the first Brillouin zone, every K point which belongs to this particular band, right? Oh, no, sorry. Let me rephrase, okay? So if I take this band, then at every point in K space, it has a certain energy Ek. But that Ek is less than the Fermi level, and hence that particular state will be fully occupied at zero Kelvin. Okay, and hence this integral that I have written here, is going to be over the entire Brillouin zone if that band is fully filled. But if that band is partially filled, right? So what do I mean by that? Let's say I draw again Ek versus K along some K direction, okay? And I find that a band is crossing something like this, okay? Then you can see that only these points in the K space are filled up for this particular band, okay? These points will be empty. So I should do the integration only over those K points for which the occupancy is one, okay? Because only those will carry the current. right? If the states are empty, then there are no electrons there, so there is no point in calculating any current. Okay, so what we are saying is that these integrals have to be calculated over the occupied space, and the occupied space is the full Brillouin zone for a filled band. Okay, so the logic depends completely on this. The integral has to be calculated over the occupied space. And the occupied space is the full Brillouin zone for a filled band. Okay. And it's a partial Brillouin zone for a partially filled band. Is this argument, is this statement clear to everyone? That the integral will be only over the partial Brillouin zone if it's a partially filled band, and it will be over the full Brillouin zone if it's a filled band. Okay, and if this is the case, if the integral is over the full Brillouin zone, then what we are going to show is that because this Ek is a periodic function in the Brillouin zone in K space, this integral over the entire Brillouin zone is going to vanish. Okay, and it's a very general statement. It's true of all periodic functions, that if you take a periodic function and integrate it over the entire period, right, then you must get zero. Okay, so that is the that's how we are going to proceed. Any doubts so far? No? Okay, so I'm going to write one statement here, which is, for any function f of r that is periodic, okay, in the Brevi lattice, that means f of r is f of r plus capital R. So I'm giving you an argument in real space, but then we will translate it to K space again. Okay, so if there is a function that is periodic on the Brevi lattice, then this integral that I'm going to write now, I r dash, which is integral over C dr f of r plus r dash, is independent of r dash, where C is the primitive unit cell. Okay, what is the statement, right? So the statement is as follows. Suppose I consider a particular function f of r, which is periodic in the Brevi lattice. Okay, so there are many functions which are periodic in the Brevi lattice. For example, you could take the Hamiltonian, the periodic potential, and many other things, right? So these are all periodic on the Brevi lattice. Now, if I take that periodic function and translate it by some arbitrary amount r dash, okay, and then integrate that function over the primitive unit cell, over the full primitive unit cell, then it turns out that this integral is independent of this arbitrary translation. Okay, you can translate it by any amount, and what you will see is that the integration is independent of that. Now this is very intuitive. Okay, so let me explain how this is very intuitive. And to explain that, let's consider a 1D lattice. Okay, and if I take this 1D lattice and this as the unit cell, right? All we are saying is, if I take a function which is completely periodic, okay, so the value of the function here and the value of the function here are exactly the same, right? And I integrate that function over this particular primitive unit cell, over this entire primitive unit cell, right? Then I will get some value. Now, if I translate this function by some arbitrary amount, right, so I get an arbitrary translation, and then it becomes this, right? So I can see that every point here can be mapped to the points which are here. Okay, so in that sense, any arbitrary translation that I do, I can then map the extra piece that is arising back to the same primitive unit cell, and hence the integral is going to be the same. Okay, so this is the essence of this argument. Does everybody understand this? That an arbitrary translation does not change the value of this integral. Is this clear? Okay.
Sir?
Yeah.
Sir, can you explain the previous statement which you made because I missed it?
Sure. Which is the this particular integral is independent of the translation?
Yeah.
Let me just remove this. Okay. So what I'm saying is that let's say I take a 1D lattice in which I have these atoms that are placed periodically, and the primitive unit cell is drawn in this way. Okay. And think of any function which is periodic on this lattice. So you could consider, for example, the periodic potential. Okay. So this f of r is a function that is periodic in this lattice. Okay, so which means f of r is equal to f of r plus an arbitrary translation, but this translation has to be with respect to the primitive lattice vectors. Okay, so if this is the case, then the statement is that if I integrate this function, but with an arbitrary translation, this r dash doesn't have to be a integral multiple of the unit vectors, of the primitive lattice vectors. Now, if I integrate this with respect to r, you see there is an integration here. But what is the volume of integration? That has to be the full unit cell. Then I would, in general, get a function I of r dash. Okay. But the statement is that if f is periodic, then this is independent of r dash. Independent of r dash. That's the statement. Okay. And to prove this statement, first I am giving you a qualitative proof, and the idea is that if I take this as the unit cell, okay, and I integrate this function with r dash equal to zero, okay, so let me take one case when r dash is equal to zero and I integrate f of r dr over the unit cell c, so this is c, okay, so if I do that, then you can see that the integral is going to give me some number, let's call it a. Okay. Now this function, okay. Yeah, if this function is translated by an arbitrary amount r dash. Okay. So let's take this f of r, and f of r is defined here. So if I do an arbitrary translation, I would end up somewhere here. Okay. But I know that this value can actually be mapped back to the first unit cell at exactly the same point in with respect to this unit cell. Okay, so in that sense, when we do an arbitrary translation of the function, we can map it back to the same unit cell, and hence this integral value remains the same. Okay, so now is the statement clear?
Yeah, okay.
And this is exactly true for multiple dimensions also. You can do an arbitrary translation in let's say a three-dimensional space, but then as soon as you do that, you can come back to the first unit cell using a lattice vector. And if you do that, you get back the same function value. Okay. But this is true only if you are integrating over the full primitive unit cell. Suppose you had integrated only over the partial unit cell. So let me give you another example. Let's take this. Okay. Again, the same example. But then the integration volume is not the full unit cell, but let's consider some partial unit cell. Let's say something like this. Okay. Let's say this is the C now over which you have to integrate. Now if I translate the function, right, in some arbitrary by some arbitrary amount, then you could end up somewhere here or here. Okay, so the periodic part is only this, right? But when I translate it, what I get is something like this, right? And then I don't get back the same function values. So only if I'm integrating over the full primitive unit cell is this integral independent of r dash. That is the statement. Okay, and this is true now of k space also, that if there is a function in k space, right, which is periodic in reciprocal space, So this is a function which is periodic in reciprocal space. Then the same statement is true that if I take the EK and then do an integration of EK over the first Brillouin zone, right, the full first Brillouin zone, then that has to be independent of any translation in K space, any arbitrary translation in K space. Okay, so if that is the case, what I can do is the following. So let me take the real space case first, I of R dash, which is integral F of R plus R dash dr dash dr, sorry, and then I take a derivative with respect to R dash. Okay, so I take grad of R dash of I of R dash. Then because this integral is over R, I can take the gradient over R dash inside this integral, and that will give me gradient of F of R plus R dash dr over R dash. Okay, but because this I of R dash is independent of R dash, the gradient of this vanishes. Hence, this has to be zero. Okay, but now you see this gradient of R dash is over, this gradient is over R dash, but the variable here is R plus R dash. Okay, so I can very well take this and then write this in the following way: gradient of R F of R plus R dash. So this is another very important step. Okay, what I've done is to interchange variables, and if I'm trying to find the derivative, let's say of a function like this, then the derivative is going to be exactly the same whether I find the derivative with respect to x or with respect to y. Okay, so this is x and y in this case, and if I try to find the derivative with respect to y, then it's going to be exactly the same if I find the derivative with respect to x. But this is very non-trivial, because now the gradient has been taken over the integration variable. Okay, and since this is zero for arbitrary R dash, this implies that this is also zero for R dash equal to zero. Okay, so this is the essence of the proof, and this is the proof that we are going to again use in K space. Okay, so how do we do that? We'll again take the EK, okay, that is EK, and then you can see that the current density was given by J is minus E integral over DK 4 pi Q 1 by H cross gradient of EK. Okay, so we can define a function which is I of K dash, which is basically the integral of this K plus K dash. Okay, and now exactly the same kind of argument that I, since this is over the full Brillouin zone, this is going to be independent of K dash. Independent of K dash. Okay, so if this is independent of K dash, then the gradient with respect to K dash of I of K dash is going to be zero, which implies that integral over dk of gradient of K of EK is going to be zero. And this implies that J is zero. Okay, so you see how we proceeded. So we showed that if you take a periodic function in some space, whether it's real space or K space, and there are discrete translations for that periodic function, then if you take that the entire period or the primitive unit cell over which it is not periodic and integrate that function over that, then whatever you get is going to be independent of any arbitrary translations also. Okay, so using that result, we could show that if you had a completely filled band, and remember, a filled band translates to an integration over the full Brillouin zone, right? If you had a partially filled band, you would integrate over the partial Brillouin zone, right? So for a filled band, we have to integrate it over the full Brillouin zone, and hence you are going to get zero current from that filled band. Okay, so does this argument make sense? Are there any questions?
sir, what is the physical reason of getting no current?
Okay, so what you are seeing from here is that if I look at the full grad of EK, right? So then what this is saying is that if you take every K space point, right, then because this function is periodic, the gradient has to be positive for some K points and negative for some other K points. Hence, the total current for this filled band is completely zero. If you take a partial Brillouin zone, then you might get a positive current or a negative current, okay, depending on the curvature and slope and so on. But if you take a completely filled band, because the EK, the gradient of EK is what determines the current, and EK is a periodic function, that gradient, okay, so in other words, what I'm saying is this. Suppose I take a completely periodic function, okay, like this, right? So this is a periodic function, right? Now, if I find the slope of this, right? So let's say I find the slope here, right? Within this period, okay, the function has to have exactly the opposite slope somewhere else. That is the idea. Okay, the negative slope of this. And that is going to cancel out the current carried by any one of the electrons. Do you see the this point?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So the total current carried by the filled band electrons is going to be zero, even though there could be finite current carried by the individual K states. Okay. But it's only because the integral is over the full Brillouin zone for a filled band, the total current carried is zero. Okay, and that statement, the word total is very important. It's not partial. Okay, that integral is over the full Brillouin zone. So the current carried by any individual K state is non-zero. Okay, that is just grad of EK minus E times grad of EK. But if you integrate it over the full Brillouin zone, that is when you get zero. And later on, you will see that this is also related to something like scattering. Okay, so if you have let me not go into that right now. But yeah, from this proof, this is the essence of the argument. Is this clear? So this is also, there is a corollary to this that only those electrons which are in partially filled bands, only the partially filled bands will basically contribute to the current, and fully filled bands will not contribute. Hence, we say that, if you find a system which has a partially filled conduction band, then you would say that it's a metal. If you have a fully filled band and the upper band is completely empty, then you would call that an insulator. Okay, so it cannot conduct, right? And if you create holes in them, then again that can start conducting. Okay, so yeah, let's see. Yeah, so that is the result which helps us to classify this entire system into metals, semiconductors, insulators, semi-metals, and things like that. And want to go? Yeah, yes.
So I have an exam at 2. Can I leave?
Yeah, that is what. It's also 1:05 now. So yeah, let's close here. And we'll meet again on Wednesday.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, sure.